Good afternoon. Today is Wednesday, the 22nd of February, 2017. And today's lecture is on the fourth gift of God to Eden, sexual organs for sexual intimacy and procreation at Eden or eternity or eternal life. The fourth gift of sexual organs for sexual intimacy and procreation was God's gift for men and women within marriage and in the home. Therefore, one of the main attacks of Lucifer is to distort these gifts so that men would not enjoy eternity and eternal life. So the devil's attack is always on the equality of men and women, sexual intimacy outside the marriage or premarital sex, the Sabbath, since it was given before the fall. Also, before the fall, these gifts include inheritance laws or land rights of ownership and not usage only. That includes minerals and whatever is in the land and above the land and in the sky and in the universe. It was for a gift of man. Let us go into the fourth gift of sexual organs for sexual intimacy and procreation. Sexual organs. First, let's look into sexual organs for intimacy. Before the beginning of creation, that is billions and trillions of years ago, when God envisioned creation, God foresaw and knew that man would be lonely, so he needed a wife and helpmate, and also to enjoy his wife, which necessitates the proof of that lifetime partner, the children of their intimate relationship of loving each other. God knew that these two beings would not leave him lonely in this world, the wife and the children. So those were the two main components that were lacking in Adam at his creation. Therefore, the other 99 Adams in the other universes or multiverses were gifted with sexual organs as well, to provide a companion and helpmate, his desires, and share his life and worship to God Elohim, who will later shower them with the heritage of God in the form of children. Genesis chapter 2 verses 18, I'm using the New American Standard Bible version or NASB. Then the Lord said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him." So that solves the problem and the issue. We can see from here that God Elohim knew that man would be lonely in two ways. He would be very lonely as a creature if he did not provide an intimate opposite gender and also a helpmate and lover. Secondly, he knew that even with the helpmate or wife, he would still be lonely, so he knew Adam had to have children of his own to make their relationship and life worth living and sharing. So God came up with a perfect innovation of sexual organs, just like animals and organisms, to meet the needs of intimacy and joy and crown of life by having children. So sexual organs are pure gifts in a perfect, holy, pure relationship between man and woman or husband and wife. Also, to have children in this pure, perfect, intimate relationship, the byproduct and the proof of this pure, intimate relationship in marriage. Therefore, first point, sexual organs are pure, for it is the perfect gift of God to mankind and creatures as well. Secondly, however, this gift must be only be used and celebrated within the confines of holy matrimony, that is in marriage, by which God Elohim is the sole provider and whose choice is to be followed, period. Not human devising or choices, as we have seen in the last lecture 7. Just like third point, just like Jesus, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit without sexual intercourse, was born sinless and pure and remained God as the Son of God and Son of Man for the pure conception by the Holy Spirit, similar to the creation of Adam in the image and likeness of God Elohim, but only with Jesus is different, for he was God and still God and born God, but would have to be incarnated as a human being in Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit. Fourth, the conception of Jesus indicates to us the purity, holiness, and divine gift of procreation by Adam and Eve, which means that their intimacy in sex and in love for marriage in love for each other is divine and pure and holy. Thus, it should not be used for fornication, that is premarital sex. And it's not used for adultery, sex outside of marriage, when one or both partners are married to another person and are engaging in sex with another opposite sex, not his wife or husband, whether he's single or married, but still adultery. Fifth point we can gather from here is that we gather now that God is in the home room during the intimacy, which is the outgrowth of pure love for each other intimately, and who are ready to procreate so that they could have children as the Trinity of the family, so it would be complete, just like the Trinity God Elohim. Therefore, any children that is born is not an accident, though it be out of wedlock, accident, that is by rape or by fraud or by ignorance and arrogance. Children will always be pure, for they are God's heritage and not humans. For the sperm and egg was the creation of God and not humans, and not the invention of men. First point we should gather from above. If they had waited for God Elohim's time, the children would still be born. And if they choose to hasten God's time, like Sarah, hastening God's promise and forcing Abraham to lie with her concubine, which resulted in the birth of a child, but was finally rejected by Sarah and Abraham, but was not rejected by God, and is today a mighty nation just like Israel today. Therefore, God has come up with a provision in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 14. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified through his wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified through her believing husband. For otherwise, your children are unclean, but they are holy now, since they are married. And Romans chapter 7, verse 2 and 3, for example, by a law, a married woman is bound to her husband as long as he is alive. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law that binds her to him. Verse 3, so then, if she has sexual relations with another man while her husband is still alive, she is called an adulteress. But if her husband dies, she is released from that law and is not an adulteress if she marries another man. That is, we are talking about marriage by law, and in fact by the blessings of the pastor. Children are holy if one of the parents is godly, though does not believe in Yahweh, but his or her life is her heart is written in the law of God, 1 Corinthians chapter 7 14, and in Romans chapter 2 verse 14-15. Indeed, when Gentiles do not have the law but do by nature things required by the law, they are law by themselves for themselves, even though they do not have the law. 15, they show that the requirements of the law are within their heart, are written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them, and at other times even defending them. So, parents, though they are not religious or believe in Yahweh, Jesus Christ, but their lives are very godly, divine, and in their lives the laws of God are written in it, their children are holy, and they are holy. Once married, then, if the husband dies, it is only this time that the woman is given the freedom to choose a husband, but should be believer and faith, period. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 39. Verse 39, a wife is bound as long as her husband lives. But if her husband is dead, she is free to be married, to whom she wishes, only in the Lord. To whom she wishes, but he must be a believer. And vice versa, a husband is free to marry if the wife dies, but she must be a believer, that is, in the Lord, the meaning. Fifth, however, St. Paul stated that it would be wise for her to remain single after the death of her husband. Similarly, the death of the wife. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 40, but in my opinion, she is happier if she remains as she is, and I think that I also have the Spirit of God. So that is what Paul is encouraging. Therefore, it is best that we look at some of the provision, that is, variable laws of marriage versus absolute laws of marriage that we have done now. Like the Ten Commandments, which is the absolute, and it is applicable for today and here on earth and in eternity, versus the variable laws, which is only applicable here on earth but not in heaven in eternity. For God in eternity will have his own will and intention, we have covered in lecture 7. These are provisions. So below are the laws and provisions of marriage, which is by mutual consent, by law, and church blessing and parents' blessing. They are not for marriages They are not for marriages that I have mentioned above of five reasons. There are provisions where God did not choose your wife, and the laws are in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 to 7 as concessions and not law. Verses 10 to 16 is an absolute law of God. Verse 10, wife must not leave husband. Verse 11, wife is allowed to leave husband such as abuse of rights or for her safety, but should not get married again, and later reconcile again to the husband if she changes. The husband must not divorce her. Verse 12, if a believing Christian husband who has an unbelieving wife who wishes to stay with him, then he must not divorce her, so it is consensual on the part of the unbelieving and not the believer. Verse 13, vice versa, if the unbelieving husband wishes to stay with a believing wife, then she is not to send him away or divorce her. Reason is that the believing spouse's prayer life has sanctified the unbelieving spouse and makes their children holy. Not like in the days of Noah, when the children were deemed unholy, for such marriages of believing spouse and unbelieving spouse was really disastrous. So Jesus' blood has power and has broken this curse after the flood. She has to wait for the new earth, the new heaven, where God will give his will and intent of her real soulmate and husband. So does the husband for the wife. In verse 15, however, if the unbelieving spouse wishes to leave or separation, then believing spouse is not bonded to him legally, but free to marry, for we are being set free by God in Jesus' blood. Verse 16, the reason is that why would you tag along with his or unbelief, infidelity, abuse, and that you will eventually savor or him, for the blood of Jesus would not be manipulated, for it was only to wash and cleanse only sins that were not committed deliberately, so unintentional sins. In verse 23, it determines that for we are redeemed. We were redeemed by the blood of Jesus. So do not become a slave to the unbelieving abuses and infidelity of your husband. So you should leave a husband when he is abusing you by law. And it's a danger to your soul and to your life and to decent living. Verse 27, if you are bound in marriage, do not seek divorce. But if you are released by a wife or husband, do not seek another wife or husband. This is if you are living separately or also divorce. If a spouse commits adultery, divorces faithful husband, or separates from faithful spouse, he or she is not free to marry while the faithful spouse is alive. But the faithful spouse can get married again, even though the unfaithful spouse is alive. But only free to marry once faithful spouse is dead, then the unfaithful spouse can get married. If the faithful spouse, even if is free to marry, still does not grant the unfaithful spouse to marry, even if she grants it to God, that unfaithful spouse is committing adultery. If the unfaithful spouse, though separated or divorced, marries again while the faithful spouse lives, the culprit spouse then is committing adultery, for he or she is not allowed to marry unless the faithful spouse dies. She or he is only free once the faithful spouse is married. Fourth, the third party who marries the culprit spouse from the previous marriage is guilty of adultery, although he or she is innocent. Fifth, the faithful spouse was divorced by the adulterous spouse, or he or she sought redress for the annulment of the marriage, then he or she is free to marry and will not commit adultery in doing so, for she was the faithful and innocent party. Sixth point, verse 39. Wife and husband is free to marry whenever spouse, then you are free to marry the choice of yours, but in the Lord. That is, the choice should be of the same faith and a believer. So there you go. Romans 3 verses, it is best that we check on Romans 3 provisions and absolutes. Verses 1, every legal marriage is binding, chapter 7, is binding with the understanding that the parents initiated and was blessed by the pastor and both families as well. Verse 2, every married woman is bound by law to her husband while he is living, also husband as well. But if he or she dies, she is released from the law and bind to her husband or wife. Verse 3, but if she is the offender of the marriage and marries another man, if she is legally separated or divorces, she commits adultery, vice versa, with the husband. if she commits adultery, if she is the offender. However, if he or she dies while living in adultery, but as soon as he or she dies, then she or he is free from that sin. Solution to the sins of absolute sins. Because most of the time, people do ask me, what about if I sin in marriage? There's provision on it. Sin of ignorance and unintentional sins. Let us look into it. Solution to the sin on absolute laws. Proof that any sin can be forgiven even if it is in the breaking of the absolute law. As I've said above and will remind us again, the Bible is not a textbook. So you can have facts in a process or proven scientifically. So the law's motive, doctrines, rituals, and sacrifice are told in a story. So it is in the absolutes. If broken, there is still hope, for the blood of Jesus is more powerful to forgive. As Paul said, St. Paul stated in Romans chapter 8, when sin abounds, grace is more abound to forgive when it is broken. Leviticus chapter 4, NASB, the law of sin offering. Verse 1, then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, verse 2, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, if a person sins unintentionally in any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, and commits any of them, verse 3, if the anointed priest sins so as to bring a guilty to the people, then let him offer the Lord a bull without defect as a sin offering for the sin he has committed. Remember, only sins that were not committed unintentional sins only, will the blood of a lamb, and later on the blood of Jesus, would blot out that sin. Let me give you an example of King David and King Saul's sins. King Saul sinned on the ceremonial law, which was a variable law, pointing to Jesus as the ritual and in the sanctuary services, and its components and priestly services and offices, while King David sinned against the Ten Commandments and the laws on marriage, which was an absolute for this earth and eternity. So the issue here is intentional sin versus unintentional sins. It is not versus absolute laws, the Ten Commandments, versus the ceremonial law. Let us see here what the absolute laws King David broke. Example number one, King David. Marriage laws, for he committed adultery. So he broke the 10th commandment, Exodus 20, 17. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, his ox, donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. He broke the 6th commandment, for he murdered Uriah, Bathsheba's husband. And he broke the 7th. Let us check, for his though. Let us check here to find out if his sin was intentional or not. For Leviticus chapter 4, as we have seen above, that the sacrifice will only be accepted if it is committed unintentionally. King David did not plan to commit adultery, for it was accidental, seeing Bathsheba bathing in the midday, as we have covered in lecture 7. And the rules of society back then is that it sets times for bathing, and men do not look down to where lower houses are when ladies and men bathe. Bathsheba did not bathe to lure David, for she was too lonely, and to even think that, and even also to think would be looking to watch her bathe. For after all, it was midday, nobody would be out in the sun, and no one would be out in the sun looking around, but in his house relaxing and enjoying the lunch break. So God judges the motive of the first actions of sin, and thus it is unintentional, though it led to the death of Uriah. But the first sin was unintentional. When they offered their sin offering, God forgave them. But the consequences of their sin, their firstborn baby died. This does not mean that it is okay to go and sin unintentionally. No, it was by accident and spur of the moment, and not wishing to sin accidentally, for it makes it intentional. If that is your plan, wishing to sin accidentally. Example 2. King Saul was advised and warned not to bring any loot for the war or conquest, or even a man or woman and children, and even manless animals, to kill all of them. But King Saul deliberately defied God and his commandments, and used his action as to excuse to offer the animals as sacrifice. The Bible said that God did not forgive him. God deemed him as a plain, deliberate, intentional sin. That is the reason his sacrifice was not accepted. Comparative study of the two examples. King David broke the absolute laws, 6 and 7. I do not have time because we have covered that. So, let me go on. Family laws are absolutes. Children are the third partnership. If not, then it is not biblical home. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28. Parents are told to bear children, so they are the third party to the Trinity of the image of God. They are the inheritance of God, the children. They are to be consulted in family matters and are obligated to the unity of the family life. Parents are obligated to provide for them as an inheritance. They are not obligated to provide inheritance to their parents. Parents should not cause them to anger. Children should love and obey their parents. So children are no accidents, even though if the marriage was not sanctioned by God. If the parents were to find the ideal spouse given by God, their current children would still be born. Therefore, the children of the other party affected would not still have born, and so the children are still God's inheritance, and no children is born by accident. As we continue throughout the years and succeeding ancestors in the Bible, I will allude to the issues of children and marriage. I will then later, through this week and months to come, would divulge more on these issues. Once we have said this, then you will understand where our ancestors had it wrong on the rituals of child sacrifice and offerings to gods and to prostitutes. I will then allude to this misconception of children in the family, in single parenting or other forms. They are all the heritage of God and not unplanned born or birth. So we have a lot to unlearn of God and His principles and grace. The second thing, sexual intercourse only after marriage is an absolute law, like the Ten Commandments, because it was given before the fall. One, sexual intimacy is only legal in marriage. It was given on the sixth day, and after God married them, they enjoyed their first sexual intimacy after opening Sabbath. It was a gift of them to them, and the opening Sabbath is always their wedding anniversary celebration, so that they would enjoy fully together and experience intimate relationship with their fellowship with their Creator. It is not a sin or taboo or immoral to have sex in any time or Sabbath, for it was a perfect gift and a perfect relationship. Thus, they were created on the sixth day. God married them, and they enjoyed each other on the opening Sabbath, which was in the Sabbath. Oh, what a blessed gift for the married couple. Sex is not for unmarried couple, period. Therefore, adultery, that is, sexual relationship between a married couple and a single or married partner, is sin or breaking that absolute law. Also, fornication is a sin, that is, when two single persons engage in this holy sacrament, for only married couple engage in sexual intercourse. Any sex outside of marriage or adultery is the theater of the devil and his evil angels. Also, any sex outside marriage by fornication is also the theater of the devil and his evil angels. Sex was a gift to mankind before sin, so it is not sin to have unless it is premarital sex and fornication or adultery. So in sex in the marriage room and in the home is very holy and it's very divine, and is guarded by the holy angels. That's why the devil and his angels cannot go into that theater. The only theater that they can go and watch live is on fornication and adultery. Angels and saints that will go to heaven will not engage in it while we are in heaven during the millennium as judged with Jesus on the throne for thus and this. After the millennium, then we will have this gift again in the new earth and the new heavens renewed. Isaiah 65, verse 17 to 25, Isaiah 66, 22 to 24, Revelation chapters 21 and 22, talking about Eden restored, where we will live as sons of man and we will bear children again. As we go on, I will expound and expose why our ancestor went wrong and why the devil is adamant that marriage is broken, but first to be unfaithful. So we will go into detail as we progress throughout the year. Conclusion onto this lecture 8. 1. For those of you who have no children, be content with your problems now, for in the new earth and the new heaven you will bear children. Secondly, for those of you who are facing marital incompatibility and irreconceivable differences, hold on and be patient. Do not be dismayed. God has a surprise for you in the new heaven and new earth on a new spouse. For those of you who now have seen how wrong were their choices, do not be dismayed. The marriage was for eternity and not for divorce, only if it was ordained by God in the first place. So chill out and wait for eternity and new earth. There are marriages forth here in this fallen earth that are godly and will remain as it is in the new earth and new heaven. So praise God for your perfect marriage. Sexual intimacy is for married couple only. 6. Having children is for married couple only. 7. Men only have the gift of sexual organ and sexual intercourse, and not angels and evil angels. Humans and angels cannot have children together, for angels do not have sexual organs, like in other esoteric studies and animist societies. Remember what Jesus said to Simon in his house and of Mary, on Mary Magdalene: "A person who has sinned more and forgiven will love one me more in heaven and the new earth, even those perfect humans who did not sin grievous sins. So I'm sure for I, Aca Tuisamoa, chief of sinner in this generation, will love Jesus more than anyone in my generation, and I'm happy for that." And when I came to realize this, Jesus comments, "I forgave my parents on my upbringing and all the bad luck I had, as I said in lecture 7, for I will love Jesus more in heaven and in the new earth, for he had forgiven me a chief sinner here on earth. May the grace of our eternal Abba Father and the love of Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit humble us to learn God's will for us, and will be the only thing that we take with us to the grave and to heaven. And so we bless God and praise his name for giving us the gift of sex, so that we can have intimacy with our partners, and then we can have children. And for us, for those of us who don't have the luxury of having children, praise God, they we will have children in the new heaven and the new earth, so that they are more blessed, for they have, do not face the evils that children face now today. So be content with what you have. God continue to bless you until the next lecture."